Welcome. Nice to see everybody out on this beautiful day. I think we're all anxious for the weather to change to our warmer spring and summer weather. Then we'll get tired of it, but that's okay. We live in southern Illinois. If we look on our blue sheet, we have the Hollybrook service today at 3 p.m. I know that Barry can use any help that anybody wants to come out and join them. Also, we have cookie day this week, so if you want to bring cookies, either homemade or bought, doesn't matter. They sure would appreciate it. It's a wonderful ministry that we have. So that's what's going on this week, as well with our children ministry. That'll be on Wednesday. We are coming down. If you look through the calendar of events, May 8th will be our last day for that ministry as we go towards the end of the school year. Are there any announcements that I have missed? Any blessings? If not, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you. Please join me and stand, please, as we sing our opening hymn, number 233, Hallelujah, Sing to Jesus, all verses.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come this day to worship you. We pray that we will gain insight on this day that will direct and guide us through the week as we go forth to share your word and your love with the world. We look at Jesus to be our example, and in doing so, we come together in prayer with the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our prayer concerns this morning include the passing of my mother-in-law, June Stanley. I'll be heading out Tuesday morning for Florida, and I'll be back the following week, and I'm switching my vacation with that week. I appreciate your prayers and your thoughts during this time. Please note the other concerns that are listed in your bulletin, and we place these before Christ. Let us prepare our hearts for a time of prayer with the singing of our prayer hymn.
Christians, we have met to worship and adore the living God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Christians, pray.
Since the upper room, after Jesus was resurrected, when he met the disciples there, he said, "May the peace be with you." And ever since then, congregations throughout the world, throughout history, have taken that blessing and they incorporated that into the worship service. And we're going to start doing that here. And in that upper room, with all the negative energy, the fear, the emotions, when Jesus spoke those words, it was the same words when he said on that turbulent sea, "Peace, be still." May your hearts find that same peace. So I ask at this time that you turn to somebody near you. And you may not know that their lives are full of storms, but may you give them the blessing of Christ and say, "The peace of Christ be with you." may the peace of Christ be with you all. Let us pray. Gracious God, you watch over us with endless love and care, and we thank you for this journey of life and all the wonders that lie before us. We are very grateful for this world that you have made, for the crystal nights and the emerald meadows, for robins and spring flowers, even the cardinals who bang up against our picture windows. Gift us with the ability to wake up each morning grateful to be fully awake and alive. Day by day, we proclaim in quiet praise of your faithfulness, O loving Lord. Master, you remind us often that life is more than worrying about our own lives. It is reaching out to others with the grace you have offered us. Help us to care about and to love those whom you love, the broken, the sinful, the suffering, the lost, even our enemies. So we pray for those who are carrying burdens that are heavier than they can manage on their own. Oh God, hear our silent prayers on their behalf. Oh God, help each one to see your face, sense the mystery in all things, and walk with you through it all. For each one of us who seeks you this morning, bring us closer to you in these challenging times. Oh Lord, we pray for generosity of spirit, that we look beyond our own desires to have the time, space, and resources to offer your grace to others in daily quiet acts of service and mercy. For in that, all people will know that we are Christ's followers, and it is in his name that we pray. Amen.
As we come to our stewardship time, some things for us to think about. Paul admonished the church in Galilee to bear one another's burdens. We have all sorts of things that come to us. A death in a family of a loved one, someone who is under an illness, someone who's going through a hard time, whatever it might be. And we often say to them, let me know if you need anything. I do it all the time. I'm sure you do it. Sometimes they reach out to us and sometimes they don't. We have to open up our hearts to hear that call from Christ. Paul's word teaches us to carry another's burden. We must sacrifice something when we do that, be it our time, our energy, or our money. But we don't have to carry the whole burden. We come together as a church family, as a community of God, to share that burden with others. And in keeping that in mind, listen to 1 John 3:16 through 18. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But if anyone has world's goods and see his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, do not let us not love in word or speech, but in truth. Father, we give thanks to you for the blessings you have bestowed upon us. May we show our love to the world as we share those blessings who are in need. We ask that you will bless those gifts that we send out into the world in your name. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Our scripture lesson today comes from the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 35 through 58. And this has the most descriptive picture of what our resurrected bodies will be like. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? And what kind of body do they come? Fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sowed, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or some other grain. But God gives us a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. Not all flesh is alike, but there is one flesh for human beings, another for animals, another for birds, and another for fish. There are both heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is one thing, and that of the earthly is another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. Indeed, star differs from star in glory. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a physical body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the physical, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we will also bear the image of the man of heaven. What am I saying, brothers and sisters? Is this, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable body must put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The word of the Lord. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, this morning's gospel lesson truly provides us with some clues concerning what our resurrected bodies will be like. When we look at Jesus after his resurrection, we know that we shall still have bodies when we rise from the dead. And basically, they will be somewhat the same. I shall look at me, perhaps a little better, I hope, but I shall still be me, and you will be you. And I'll be able to recognize you, and you'll be able to recognize me. We shall still be the same person. But however, like Jesus, we shall not be locked in by anything, not even our old hang-ups and all our emotional baggage. For at the resurrection, I shall be a perfected me, able to do everything I always like to do and wish to do. Only I shall be able to do them better. Paul has a beautiful way of talking about the meaning of death and what God will do about it. He says it in this passage. Remember, here's what Paul says. He says, at the final resurrection, our bodies will be like beautiful plants that spring from seeds. All kinds of seeds. Take, for instance, a beautiful rose. It needs to have a seed, or it will never be a rose. But once it grows, where is the seed? To be sure, the rose came from a seed, but the seed is no longer there. In a sense, it has died. Paul suggests that our lives are like these little seeds. The bodies that you and I have, the lives that we are living, are a bit like the seeds that God plants. Someday a beautiful plant will grow from that seed. And that plant which will stem from you is your resurrected body. The perfect you. The way God originally intended you to be. Now, of course, for all that to happen, in order for your resurrection body to grow, that seed has to disappear. It has to die. We die so that the beautiful plant, the perfect you and me, can blossom in the sunlight of God's love. The perfect you and me without our hang-ups and shortcomings, the way we would have been if we had not made bad decisions, sin, or had not been victimized by the sin of others and institutional evil. This is what we have to look forward to after we pass, when Jesus comes again. That stranger on the road to Emmaus demonstrated to those two followers of his what our resurrected bodies will be like. I don't know about you, but there's something so wonderful in these images. In eternal life, I am going to be me. To have a body similar to this one. To be able to do the things that I do well, but do those things better. Yes, that certainly beats playing a harp and flying around heaven all day. Bear, I think he would rather play a guitar. There is something beautiful in the Christian image of the resurrected life. It's almost majestic in its beauty. The message of Jesus on the cross is that God loves our unique personalities, our passions, our uniqueness. And God loves us so much that he wants us to be ourselves forever without the baggage, without the regrets, without the sin and the frailties. What? When you think about the resurrected life in this way, The words that Paul once wrote really make sense. They are the final word that needs to be spoken about death and the resurrection. O death, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting? May God bless you, and may the peace of Christ be with you. Would you please stand and give your allegiance to Christ as we sing our hymn of dedication.
Jesus is tenderly calling thee home, calling today, calling today. Why from the sunshine of love wilt thou roam further and further away? Calling today, calling today. Jesus is calling, is tenderly calling today. Jesus is calling the weary to rest, calling today, calling today. Bring him thy burden and thou shalt be blessed. He will not turn thee away. Calling today, calling today. Jesus is calling, is tenderly calling today. Jesus is waiting, oh come to him now. Waiting today, waiting today. Come with thy sins at his feet lowly bow. Come and no longer delay. Calling today, calling today. Jesus is calling, is tenderly calling today.
Brothers and sisters, Christ invites all of us, as we are, to his table. And may we remember his love, his forgiveness, but more importantly, that we follow him in those things. May we be faithful.
Let us pray. Good Shepherd, like helpless sheep we gather, needing your guidance. We hunger, we thirst, we are afraid. Like Paul, blinded on the road to Damascus, we need someone to take us by the hand, to heal us, to receive us into your community of faith. We thank you for this table set before us, and especially for this bread and cup. For in it, we taste and experience the love, safety, and leadership of your fold. As we eat this bread and drink of this cup, we are fed by the love of the one who is at once the Lamb of God and the great shepherd of the sheep, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And we now remember the gift that Christ gave us in that upper room, this table of remembrance. When he took the loaf, he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." And in the same manner, he took the cup. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Take and drink." Gracious God, we have done as you have commanded, that whenever we meet, we do this in remembrance of that great sacrifice of Christ, in that he makes us one body, an indestructible body. May we shine with the love of Christ in this dark world. Give us the power of your Spirit, and may we find peace. In your Son's name we pray. And may you follow the light of Christ into God's world, and remember that you are to participate in Christ's ministry, to follow his teachings, and to love as Christ loved.